And I came to tell you, it's coming down, it's coming down. Come on, get up and let's help us do this song right here. Come on, choir. Let's sing it like we back in the 80s.
They gotta come.
I'm telling you, they gotta come.
Good morning, Saints of God. I'm Sister Linda Whitaker coming to you from Good Samaritan Church under the leadership of Mother Lola Mitchell and Bishop Henry Mitchell. I thank God for this opportunity to come before you with the Word of God. Pray much for me. In the name of Jesus, we're going to go before the Lord in prayer. We thank you, God, for this opportunity to just, Lord God, just share your word with your people, Lord God. We know that you are the Lord of Lords and the King of Kings. I pray, Lord God, that the Holy Spirit will lead me according to his will and not mine, removing all the self out of the way, Lord God, and you just come up, Lord God, and do your will. In the name of Jesus, I pray, Father God, amen. Thank you. And good morning again. I'm going to be coming to you from Samuel, 1 Samuel 17. And the title is Facing Our Goliath. What will you use to slay your giant? So just give you some background here. I'm going to read some of 1 Samuel 17. Now the Philistines gathered together their armies to battle and were gathered together at Shochoth, which belongeth to Judah, and pitched between Shochoth and Azekah in Ephesidom. And Saul and the men of Israel were gathered together and pitched by the valley of Elon and set the battle in array against the Philistines. And the Philistines stood on a mountain on the one side, and Israel stood on a mountain on the other side. And there was a valley between them, and there went out a champion out of the camp of the Philistines named Goliath of Gath, whose height was 6 cubits and a span. So we're looking at 9 feet, 10 feet, 9 feet, 9 inches, 10 feet. And he had an helmet of brass upon his head, and he was armed with a coat of mail, and the weight of the coat was 5,000 shekels of brass, over 1,000 pounds we're talking here. And he had greaves of brass upon his legs and a target of brass between his shoulders. And the staff of his spear was like a weaver's beam, and his spear's head weighed 600 shekels of iron, and one bearing a shield went before him. And he stood and he cried unto the armies of Israel and said unto them, why are ye come out and set your battle in array? Am not I a Philistine, and ye servants to Saul? Choose you a man for you, and let him come down to me. If he be able to fight with me and to kill me, then we will be your servants. But if I prevail against him and kill him, then shall ye be our servants and serve us. And the Philistine said, I defy the armies of Israel this day. Give me a man that we might fight together. When Saul and all Israel heard those words of the Philistine, they were dismayed and greatly afraid. Now David was the son of the Ephratite of Bethlehem, Judah, whose name was Jesse. And he had 8 sons. And the man went among men for an old man in the days of Saul. And the 3 eldest sons of Jesse went and followed Saul to the battle. And the names of these 3 sons that went to the battle were Eliab, the firstborn, and the next unto him, Abinadab, and the 3rd son, Shammah. And David was the youngest, and the 3 eldest followed Saul. But David went and returned from Saul to feed his father's sheep at Bethlehem. And the Philistines drew near morning and evening and presented himself 40 days. And Jesse said unto David, his son, take now the brethren an ephah of this parched corn and these 10 loaves and run to the camp to thy brethren. And carry these 10 cheeses unto the captain of their thousands and look how thy brethren fare and take their pledge. Now Saul and they all and all the men of Israel were in the valley of Elah fighting with the Philistine. And David rose up early in the morning and left the sheep with a keeper and took and went as Jesse had commanded him. And he came to the trench as the host was going forth to fight and shouted for the battle. For Israel and the Philistines had put the battle in array, army against army. And David left his carriage in the hand of the keeper of the carriage and ran into the army and came and saluted his brethren. And as he talked with them, behold, there came up the champion, the Philistine of Gath, Goliath by name, out of the armies of the Philistines, and spake according to the same words, and David heard them. And all the men of Israel, when they saw the men, fled from him and were sore afraid. And the men of Israel said, have you seen this man that is come up? Surely to defy Israel is he come up. And it shall be that the man who killeth him, the king will enrich him with great riches, and will give him his daughter, and make his father's house free in Israel. And David spake to the men and stood by him, saying, what shall be done to the man that killeth this Philistine, and taketh away the reproach from Israel? For who is this uncircumcised Philistine, that he should defy the armies of the living God? And the people answered him after this manner, saying, so shall it be done to the man that killeth him. And Eliab, his oldest brother, heard when he spake unto the men. And Eliab's anger was kindled against David. And he said, why camest thou down hither? And with whom hast thou left those few sheep in the wilderness? I know thy pride and the naughtiness of thine heart. For thou art come down that thou might see the battle. And David said, what have I done? Is there not a cause? And he turned from him toward another and spake after the same manner. And the people answered him again against the former manner. And when the words were heard which David spake and rehearsed them before Saul, and he sent for him. And David said to Saul, let no man's heart fail because of him. Thy servant will go and fight this Philistine. And Saul said to David, thou art not able to go against this Philistine to fight with him, for thou art but a youth, and he a man of war from his youth. And David said unto Saul, thy servant kept his father's sheep, and there came a lion and a bear, and took a lamb out of the flock. And I went after it, and smote him, and delivered it out of his mouth. And when he arose against me, I caught him by his beard, and smote him, and slew him. The servant slew both the lion and the bear. And this uncircumcised Philistine shall be as one of them, seeing he hath defied the armies of the living God. Glory to God. David said, moreover, the Lord that delivered me out of the paw of the lion and out of the paw of the bear, he will surely deliver me out of the hand of this Philistine. And Saul said to David, go, and the Lord be with you. And Saul armed David with his armor and put him on the helmet. I'm going to go on down to 40. And David took his staff in his hand and chose him 5 smooth stones out of the brook, 5, and put them in a shepherd's bag, which he had even in a scrip, and his sling was in his hand, and he drew near to the Philistine. And the Philistine came on and drew near unto David, and the man that bare the shield went before him. Here, reading on, this is where the Philistine mocked David because of his size. Verse 45, then said David to the Philistine, thou comest to me with a sword and with a spear and with a shield, but I come to thee in the name of the Lord of hosts and the God of the armies of Israel, whom thou hast defiled. This day the Lord shall deliver thee into my hand, and I will smite thee and take thine head from thee, and I will give the carcasses of the host of the Philistines this day unto the fowls of the air and to the wild beasts of the air, to the earth, and all the earth may know that there is a God in Israel. And all this assembly shall know that the Lord saveth not with sword and spear, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give you into our hands. Praise God. And it came to pass when the Philistine arose and came and drew nigh to meet David, that David hasted and ran toward the army to meet the Philistine. And David put his hand in his bag and took thence a stone and slang it and smote the Philistine in his forehead, that the stone sunk into his forehead and he fell unto his face to the earth. So David prevailed over the Philistine with a sling and with a stone, and smote the Philistine and slew him. But there was no sword in the hand of David. And when Saul saw this, when he saw what David had done, I'm paraphrasing now, Saul was wondering, who was this man? And David answered, I am the son of thy servant Jesse, the Bethlehemite. So here, we know that David was the son of Jesse, and we know what David did to Goliath, his giant, and the giant for the Israelites as well. But what are we doing? What are we doing to face our giants? What will we use to slay our giant? What will you use to slay your giant? David picked up five smooth stones. So I want to talk about these five smooth stones that we can use in our life, our daily life, that we can conquer, defeat, give a black eye to our Goliath, whatever that Goliath may be. The first stone is the stone of the past. How many of us have encountered things in our lives where we have, as God's people, look back, reflected, recalled, and thought on those things and said, Lord, you did it for me before. I know that you'll do it again. So that is the same way we have to do, because that's exactly what David did. David brought back to our attention what he had done to the bear and the lion. David showed us that he knew he served a great big God. He knew he served a God that was able to eliminate any Goliath in our lives, any Goliath. So he took that bear and that lion, and he killed them. So we, in that same manner, we can take the stone of the past, thinking back, what have God done for us? I know I have many things in my life that God has done for me. He has shown me over and over again. He has even spoken to me, God, hallelujah, through the Holy Spirit, and shown me, like, I did this for you. I've done this already for you. And I just, and immediately recognizing how the Holy Spirit speaks to me and shares with me what he's done for me, I said, I thank you. And you, as God's people, we all need to do the same thing. We need to recall what God has done for us in our lives. And we need to think on that first stone, that stone of the past. Maybe we'll use that to defeat our Goliath, whatever it may be. You may use that. Praise God. Hallelujah. There's another stone. The stone a priority. As I read through the scripture, as I read through 1 Samuel 17, I was thinking about stone of priority. What is that? What does that mean? What does that mean? So when I think about David and how he prioritized, how he put things in order, you know, he tended the sheep. Not only did he tend the sheep, he was obedient to his father and as well as to Saul. It says in here, David was the youngest, the three oldest, verses 14 and 15. But David went back and forth from Saul to tend his father's sheep at Bethlehem. Wait a moment. He went back to Saul and to tend his father's sheep. Then I realized, okay. So I went back and read up a little closer, up a little further rather. So I looked in chapter 16, where David was beckoned for or called on because God placed a tormenting spirit upon Saul that took him to a place where he was just restless. And someone knew of someone who played this harp and played it so very well that they thought that it could be used to calm the spirit of Saul. Again, Jesse's son David was called upon. So David was already tending to Saul. He was going to Saul, praise God, and he was playing his harp for him. So Saul wanted to keep him in his home for this reason, because when God's tormenting spirit came upon Saul, God had Saul had David to calm him. Again, this obedience got David recognizing how he needed to prioritize. He needed to make sure that he had things in order, knowing that he was tending his father's sheep as well as tending to Saul. But when his father had asked him to go to the tent, to the camp, and to take food to the men, David prioritized. He put things in order like we do. We need to make sure we're putting things in order. We spoke this morning, we spoke in reference to sister, and we talked about how we need to make sure that we are putting God in our lives, and we are claiming him first thing in the morning when we get up, so that we know that he will be with us. He will be in our presence at all time. And that's what David did. David made sure that he was obedient to his father and to Saul. He tended them both. He did what his father asked him to do, as well as what Saul had asked him to do. Praise God. And we are in the same way, seeking the Lord early in the morning. What is your early? If you work nights in, it may not be 5 o'clock in the morning. So whatever is your early, you seek God and the Holy Spirit and your guidance throughout the day. I realize that, praise God, that sometimes I'm learning to say no sometimes to things. And I know David, I believe he did the same thing. He knew there was things that he needed to take care of. I think he said no to that brother who, thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I know that he said no to that brother that went up against him and was speaking ill against him because he was coming and he was speaking in reference to what they were doing about this giant, this Goliath in their life. And how would they continue to allow this giant to defile the name of our true and living God? So first stone, the stone of the past. Recognizing what God has done for you. The stone of priority, recognizing how we must keep things in order. And first of all, knowing that God is head of our life and that we need to also make sure that we prioritize and place him there. Thank you, Jesus. Under the word of God, making sure that we use his word. Joshua 1:9 tells us, "Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Don't be frightened and do not be dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go." I was reading somewhere where it says that fear, it tells us that fear is false evidence appearing real. False evidence appearing real. And that is what happens with us all the time when we think about it. During this pandemic, all that is going on, you know, we see things that are happening. We just, in our hearts, in our mind, this is the natural. This is what happens in the natural. We believe that something could come upon us or our family member. But we can trust and believe that God said he does not give us a spirit of fear, but of a love and a peace and a sound mind. Thank you, Jesus. Again, Lamentations 2, 22, 23. Because of the Lord's great love or mercies, we are not consumed, for his compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Thank you, Jesus, for the new mercies that you give us every single morning. I don't get any leftover mercies. I'm not getting mother's leftover mercies. I'm not getting my husband's leftover mercies. My mercies are new every morning. Your mercies are new every morning. Hallelujah. Praise God. We need to know that our mercies are new every morning that we wake up our eyes, open our eyes to the Lord. Our mercies are new. Praise God. Psalms 91:7 says, 1,000 may fall at my side and 10,000 at your right hand, but it will not come near you. All that is happening in this world, all that is happening in this world is in this world and not in God's people. That we know that we can trust him and depend on him and that he's not going to let anything come near us. Nothing to defile us, nothing to hurt us. Praise God. My third stone, stone of prayer. That prayer, that stone is always in order. Always in order. Hallelujah. We are to always pray. We hear that all the time. Pray without ceasing. We know prayer is what we do. We do it faithfully. But interceding is what we are called to do. We are called to pray for one another, to lift each other up, to encourage one another. We are called to do that. We are called to make sure that our people, that God's people, are held on. We are going before the Lord before
in regards to our people, to God's people, that is. So in the good and in the bad, this is how we communicate. We pray. We pray. And then we listen. And then we listen. He desires our presence. He adores our presence. Our confessions that we come to him with. Our thanksgiving over and over again. If that's all you can say is thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. That is more than enough. I promise you. Just saying thank you, Jesus. He will come in. And supplications on behalf of others, as I stated before, praying much. 1 Thessalonians 5:15-18. See that no one repays anyone evil for evil, but always seek to do good to one another and to everyone. Rejoice always. Pray without ceasing. Give thanks in all circumstances, in all, the good and the bad, all circumstances. Hallelujah. For this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you and for me. Matthew 6:9, Jesus teaches his disciples to pray. Read it. It tells us, it shows us step by step what the Lord Jesus Christ said to his disciples and how they should pray. And we know that David prayed. We can look at many, many Psalms, probably more than half of the Psalms in the book of the Bible, David has penned. Prayers to the Lord Jesus Christ. Prayers over and over again of how God has delivered him. How he know that wherever he may be, no matter what is going on with him, that he know that he can call on God. He can call, and we can do the same thing. And I want to think about, I was looking, reading 1 Samuel 27:1-4. And for that moment, David left. He left Saul. He left all of them. And I was thinking, well, Lord, Is that a spirit of defeat for David? Was David feeling like that he was defeated, that he had to run away? And I was thinking, so with that, when we run away from God, or when we run, we think we're running away from our Goliath, that is not happening. What tends to happen is that you tend to pile on more and more and more. You tend to pile on more troubles for yourself instead of facing them, which means going to the Lord, looking to prayer, looking at what he's done for you in the past, and prioritizing, seeking God every day. Because if we're not careful, our Goliath will lead to another Goliath. Evil plays tricks on you. It's manipulative. But you know what? As children of God, we recognize it. We may ignore it, which is the wrong thing to do, but we recognize it. Praise God. Hallelujah. And I'm so glad that I can recognize it. I'm so glad that his spirit lives in me and I can truly recognize that evil spirit that's either coming upon me or that someone else. That discernment. I appreciate God for his Holy Spirit that gives me that discernment, that gives me that spirit to recognize what is not of him, what is not of God. David inquired of the Lord for instructions and directions. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? And then Colossians 4:2. Continue steadfastly in prayer, being watchful in it with thanksgiving. Ephesians 6:10. That's our theme prayer. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might. Let's give Goliath in our lives, the Goliath in your life, a black eye. Stomp on him. Do whatever it takes. Prayer. Prioritizing. Seeking the Lord. So that we may encourage one another. Proverbs 27:17. As iron sharpens iron, so one man sharpens another. And that's what we do when we pray to the Lord on behalf of one another, when we call and encourage one another. Because when we call to encourage, we are also encouraging ourselves. More than anything, whatever that was going on with you in your heart and what was going on in your mind, praise God. Praise God. It just vanishes. And it doesn't just vanish. God just takes it away. He gives us peace. And I'm so grateful that when I put one of the saints on my heart and in prayer, and I'm praying on behalf of them, whatever may be going on in my life, I know that seeking the Lord on behalf of others, God will deliver me as well. And I'm so glad for that. And we should be grateful for that. The fourth stone, that stone of passion. Praise God. Passion, that strong, intense will to do, a driving force, a powerful, a compelling emotion, whether it's love or hate. David's passion for the living God gave him courage to run toward Goliath. Verse 47 says, "All those gathered here will know that it is not by sword or spear that the Lord saves. For the battle is the Lord's, and he will give all of you into our hands." That's what God does. That's his battle, and that's what we need to learn to do. And we know the natural sometimes is hard to do, but we do it. We do it. You do it. You do it. No matter how hard it may be, you do it, and you just rest in God. Jesus, I'm giving it to you. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. David's true passion was after the Lord. We must have that same passion. We need to draw near to God daily. Get up early in the morning, whatever it may be, whatever your early may be, and seek the Lord. Asking the Holy Spirit to guide you throughout your day. Acts 22:13 says, "And when he had removed him, he raised up David to be their king, of whom he testified and said, 'I have found in David, the son of Jesse, a man after my heart, who will do all my will.'" His heavenly Father, our heavenly Father, that's what we're desiring. For God to say that I, Sister Whitaker, he's after my heart, or I'm after his heart. Praise God. You are seeking the heart of God. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. Glory to God. We must glorify him daily. Thank you, Jesus. Seek after him with all your heart, with all your soul, your mind. Seek after him. And I promise you, he will. He will smile upon you. Just calling his name, Jesus. Just calling his name immediately puts you in his presence. Isn't that great to know that when you call on Jesus, you are immediately in his presence? Immediately. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And I'm so glad that I know that when I just call on his name, just saying his name places me in his presence. And the same for you. The last stone, the stone of persistent, lasting, enduring, persevering, continuing on and on, persevering, seeking after God more and more and more and more. Persevere towards the Lord. We can't trouble God. Do you believe that? We can't trouble him. He says, I'm going to go to Luke 18. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. Luke 18. 1-8. And we've read this before, but I just want to share this with you because sometimes we feel like when we go to the Lord Jesus Christ and we say things to him and we thank him for it, and then we go to him again and we thank him for it, and we go to him again and we thank him for it. But God says we can't trouble him. And I believe that I can't trouble him. It says, Jesus told us this parable. And he spoke a parable unto them to this end, that men ought always to pray and not to faint. Saying, there was a city, a judge, which feareth not God, neither regarded man. And there was a widow in that city. And she came unto him, saying, avenge me of mine adversary. And he would not for a while. But afterward, he said within himself, though I fear not God, nor regard man, yet because this widow troubleth me, I will avenge her,
lest by her continual coming she weary me. And the Lord said, hear what the unjust saith, the unjust judge saith. And shall not God avenge his own elect, which crieth day and night unto him, though he bear long with them? I tell you that he will avenge them speedily. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man cometh, shall he find faith on the earth? So God is saying, this judge, this woman, this widow woman continually went to the judge, asking this judge to do this. Vindicate for me this day, vindicate for me. And eventually the judge just gave in and said, okay, fine, take care of this widow woman for me, and took care of her need. But Jesus is telling us, we're his children. You don't think he'll do the same thing for us? When we cry out to him, we call on him, holy, holy, holy God, we know that you're able, and he will do it for us. Cry out to him over and over and over again. Seek his face over and over and over again. It is not too much. We're not troubling the Lord. He desires that. He desires us to get into his presence. He desires that. He desires us to be persistent with getting into his presence. And as I've stated before, David was persistent about getting before the Lord. Said he was a man after God's own heart. That's what God said about David. So let us today, this day, know that whatever stone that we may choose to use to slay our Goliath, whatever it may be in our lives, praise God, that we will do so because we know that we serve a God who is able to do all things but fail. There's nothing too hard for him. Nothing impossible with him. Hallelujah. Nothing impossible with him. And I praise God for that. Nothing impossible with you, Lord. Even though when things tend to look really grim, no matter what the Goliath may be, we know that it is fear. False evidence. False evidence appearing real, Lord. We know that. And we know that you don't give us a spirit of fear. And we are so grateful, glory to God. And we can lift your name on high. Know, Lord God, that you got us no matter what. No matter what, glory to God, you have us. You got our back, our fronts, our side. You always go before us and prepare a place for us. On this earth, this day, you go before us, Lord God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. And you prepare a place for us. No matter where we're going in life, Jesus, you prepare a place for us, no matter where it may be, as long as we're staying in your will. Jeremiah 29:11, I believe, for I know the plans that I have for you, plans to prosper you, plans to give you hope and a future. You, Lord God, have that plan for us. And that plan, of course, has to be in the future. Thank you, Jesus. Right now, Lord God, we believe you for that. And we love you, Lord God, for you are worthy of all our praise. All our praise. There's nothing that we should not be saying hallelujah to you, Lord God. We should be lifting your name up. We should be saying hallelujah. We should be lifting your name up. We should be glorifying you all the time, Lord God. Whenever you're doing things around the house, glorify the Lord in all things, upon all circumstances. Glorify the Lord. For he loves us. And I truly appreciate you, Lord. I appreciate you, Lord God, for letting us know that what stone will we use to slay our Goliath, whether it's the stone of past, of our past, what you've done for us before, that we know that you'll do it again, Lord. Stone of prioritizing, priority, putting things in order, making sure that we are doing your will, Lord God, seeking after you, prioritizing, so important. That we are not busy doing things of this world, just busy doing nothing, but making sure that we're keeping our mind stayed on you. We are focused, Lord God. We are focused on you. And when we feel like, Lord God, we are straying, that just call on your name and right, just like that, Jesus, you'll bring us back into your presence. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. You'll bring us back into your presence when our mind goes astray. When things are starting to bother us, because we know that's where the attack is at, Lord. And you'll bring us right back when we call on your holy name. Thank you, Jesus. Stone of prayer. As I stated before, always in order. Prayer is always in order. And we know when we pray to you, Lord God, you hear us. And now, with that prayer, you desire that we listen to what you have to say. You give us an answer, but we have to have the heart and the mind stayed on you, focused on you, and listen to what you have to say to us. And I'm so glad that my spirit, my body, my mind is in tune to the Holy Spirit. So when you speak to me, when you tell me to go left, to go right, to do this or do that, that I hear you and I obey. I am truly glad, Lord. Stone of passion. Yes, yes, yes. Having that grand love for our God, because he did for us. He sent his only begotten son to die on the cross for us. Surely, surely we should have that same passion. He breathed his breath of life into us. Surely I want to praise him. Surely I want to lift his name on high. Surely I want to follow you, Lord. Surely I want to follow you. That stone of passion for you, God. And that persistent stone. Just seeking after you continually. Thank you, Jesus. Seeking after you continually. You are worthy of all the praise. And I'm truly grateful. Truly grateful, Lord God, for the stones that you have allowed us to have, Lord God, to use for our lives. And that we will look to them when we are facing a Goliath. We thank you, Lord God. Glory to God in the name of Jesus. Thank you for the word that you have given your people, Lord. I truly bless your holy name. And I know, Lord God, that you will just continue to bless your people all over the land, Lord. Thank you for who you are. You're worthy of all the praise. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Thank you. Amen. Amen.
Encourage yourself.